professor Ton de Waal. He's studied mathematics at Leiden University. He holds a PhD at Erasmus University. Since 1993, he has been a senior consultant at Statistics Netherlands. And his expertise is related to data editing, imputation, non-response, and statistical disclosure control. He's author of two books about statistical disclosure control and also a book published by Wiley with the title Statistical Data Editing, Imputation and Non-Response. I mention the title explicitly because if you read the name of the seminar, you realize that we should also give him a credit because we copied the title of the book to announce this seminar. Thanks very much to having accepted the invitation, please.
Would have been here. Ja, ja.
Maar dit is niet voor om vooruit te gaan.
Oh. Die is vooruit en achteruit. Oké, ja, I guess I understand it. Good morning, everyone. Welcome. My presentation is called Discovering the Truth and the Unknown. It almost sounds like the title of a political speech, and perhaps it is. But in any case, I'm going to give an overview of various methods for editing and a few methods for imputation. I'm going to try this. Let's first introduce myself, as Johan already said a few things about me. I studied mathematics. I studied almost everything except statistics. I did an introductory course statistics, but I found it was a waste of time. And decided to have nothing to do with it for the rest of my life. But somehow, someone at Statistics Netherlands still hired me. And since 1993, I'm a methodologist at Statistics Netherlands. And I worked on statistical disclosure control, statistical data editing and imputation. And nowadays, data integration. And I hope, since 2014, I'm a professor in data integration. And I hope to find out what data integration could possibly mean. But we're working on it. Now, you can forget everything I said so far, because now we move on to something much more important, and that is I'm also a grandfather of two grandchildren. These two very beautiful boys are Julio on the left. He's the eldest one, he's 5 years old, and Lucio on the left, he's on the right, he's 3 years old. Lucio is only interested in trains. And Julio, he wants to become a Spider-Man later in life because he wants to save people. And I remember when I was young, I also wanted to save people, but apparently something went wrong because now I'm giving talks about statistical data editing. What I'm going to say, I'm basically giving an overview of statistical data editing and a bit about a little bit about imputation, because there are other speakers here who can tell you much more about imputation, and they will do this this morning already. I can repeat what's saying there, but you can read it for yourself. I will present this. Well, what is statistical data editing? Well, statistical data editing is discovering the truth. At statistical offices, we get a lot of information. But unfortunately, there are a lot of mistakes in the data, and some things are just completely untrue. And we hope to discover the truth by editing the data. You can also say that statistical data editing is the process of detecting and correcting errors in the data. It can be divided into 3 steps, and if you think about it, you can probably divide it in 20 steps, but I divide it in 3 steps. The first step is you find the records that contain mistakes. Then you find in those records the fields or the variables that contain mistakes. And the last step is that you replace the mistakes by better values, and that's the link to imputation. Why is it useful? Well, the first reason why statistical data editing is useful is that it leads to data of higher quality. And that's obviously very important. Well, another reason why at least the modern techniques for statistical data editing are important is that, well, in the traditional form, and I will explain the traditional forms later on, with the traditional form, statistical data editing costs a lot of time, and it costs especially a lot of money. But we don't have a lot of money, and we don't have a lot of time either. So therefore, we moved on to more modern forms, and the modern forms, they save a lot of money and time in comparison to the old methods. A question that's interesting for people who are studying or people who are working at the statistical office is why is it interesting? And that's a difficult question. I found it really difficult to answer this question, but fortunately I'm also an academic researcher, and I know when you have a question that you can't answer, you just answer a simpler question, and I will do that later. I seem like a politician here, because if they get a question they can't answer, they just answer a completely different question. Or at least I will answer a related question, and that is, why do I like statistical data editing? I like statistical data editing because there are a lot of different topics. There are a lot of different aspects. It is statistics, of course. There's a lot of statistics involved. But it's not only statistics. You also have process control. You have process optimization. You want your editing process, editing methods to run as smoothly as possible. You also have teaching and communicating with humans. You have to explain them the methods and explain them that it's important to use these methods in the way you specify them. And of course, you also have mathematics. And personally, I am a mathematician, and I still find statistics, well, I find statistics interesting nowadays, but only barely. And I know what process control and process optimization are, but that's almost all I know about these topics. And as I said, I'm a mathematician, so I certainly don't like to communicate with people. If I like to communicate with something, it's computers, and even they don't do what I want them to do. And humans certainly don't want to do what I want them to do. So what my main interest is, I'm mainly interested in mathematics. So I'm interested in operations research techniques. How can you optimize something under certain constraints? I'm also interested in combinatorics or even mathematical logics. And you'll find all these different things in the field of statistical data editing. Well, an overview. I will now try to give an overview of all various statistical data editing methods. I will start in the very old days. In the very old days, and very old days is somewhere before the 1950s. Statistical data editing was a manual process. People checked the data that they had on forms, and then they corrected the data, and then they hoped that what they did was correct, and that they indeed got data of better qualities, better quality. Since somewhere around the 1950s, computers were for the first time used in the statistical data editing process. And at that moment in time, they were used for checking the data. And correcting the data was still done manually by people. And you often had several cycles then. Data came in and people corrected and they were checked by the computer. People got long lists of all kinds of error messages. People started correcting the data. They did it manually. After that, the data were again entered into the mainframe computer. Mainframe computer again checked everything, and again there were a long list of errors messages. And again, people started to edit the data, and hopefully, and that happened in several cycles. And hopefully, that converged at some moment. And then people were happy. But in any case, it was a very expensive and a very slow process. It could take forever. If you had a question about your data, you could ask it, and maybe 5 years later you got an answer. Well, in any case, that's a lot better than if you ask a question to a politician. You'll never get an answer back. But it took a long time. It took about 5 years or so before you get an answer. I mentioned the word checking several times, but I haven't explained how you can do that. I will explain how we do it at statistical offices. You can check the data by applying outlier detection techniques. And then you assume that the outliers are the records that probably contain mistakes. And I won't say anything about this. Because there are a lot of statistical books about outlier detection techniques. What we mainly use at statistical offices are edit rules. Edit rules are rules that somehow describe what we know about the world. And often these are logical things that we know about the world. And in other cases, they are not completely logical, but they are based on statistical analysis. And if the data that we have do not satisfy our edit rules, we either assume that there is a mistake in the data, or in any case, we assume that it's implausible, that it's likely that there is a mistake in the data. whatever we do, if we know for certain there's a mistake, we try to correct it. If we're not completely certain, often someone has to look at the data and correct the data manually. Well, what are examples of such edit rules? First example is that the profit of an enterprise should be equal to the turnover of the enterprise minus the costs that the enterprise has made. And that, I hope that the restriction always has to hold. Another example is that the man cannot be pregnant. I guess that's still true. A third example is that the profit of an enterprise should be less than 50% of its total turnover. This is an example of what we call a soft edit. The other two are so-called hard edits. The hard edits always have to hold true. But the soft edits, they are based on statistical analysis or our general knowledge of the world. There may be enterprises that have a profit that is larger than 50% of its total turnover. But if I ever happen to find such an enterprise in my data, I'll quit my job and start an enterprise like that, because it would be highly attractive to have such an enterprise. Another example of a soft edit is that a woman cannot have given birth to more than 20 children. It is possible, but it's rare. And I'm not completely sure if it will make you happy to have more than 20 children. So we have hard edits and soft edits, and we use that to check the data and to correct the data later. What are modern forms of statistical data editing? I will describe four modern forms: interactive editing, selective editing, automatic editing, and macro editing. These methods are all much more efficient than the old manual process that took forever and cost an enormous amount of money. First of all, interactive editing, it's quite similar to manual editing. When the first personal computers became popular somewhere in the 1980s or maybe even the early 1990s, interactive editing became popular. And what is interactive editing? The important point of interactive editing is that you can check and correct the data at the same time. In the old manual process, you first had to had a computer that checked the data, then you corrected the data manually, then you had the computer again that checked it again, and later you corrected it manually again. But here you can do it at the same time. You can the computer gives error messages, you start correcting the data, and you can immediately see on your screen what the effects are. Do you have more or less failed edits? And what are the distributional aspects of correcting the data? So you can see immediately what you're doing. Does it help to correct the data or not? And because you can do it in one step, you don't need several cycles of checking and correcting. And this immediately, the immediate feedback, well, it helps people to correct the data. So that saves a lot of money and a lot of time. Well, there is one big drawback of interactive editing. Well, it saves a lot of time when you try to correct one record, but still, basically, you have to correct all the records. So you have to go through all the records and check them one by one. Another drawback that I did not mention. What's the other drawback? The other drawback is that you may edit too much. If you start editing and you're really working hard on it, you may end up in a situation that you start editing records that are correct but are suspicious or slightly suspicious. So you may be over-editing. You may think that you are correcting the data, but in fact you're making the data worse. So one of the dangers of interactive editing is that you're doing too much. And as we all know, if you do something too much, that's not good. If you drink too much, that's bad for your health. And if you edit too much, that's bad for the quality of your data. It's as simple as that. One new technique also arose somewhere in the 1990s, I guess. Selective editing, and that the idea of selective editing is to overcome the two drawbacks of interactive editing. Selective editing aims to identify the records with the most important errors. So you're not going to do all the records, but only the ones with the most important errors. And that also prevents you against over-editing, doing too much, because you're only looking at a selected number of records. The idea, only look at the records with the influential errors. And well, there's many different ways to do that. But the most common form up to now is to base it on so-called score functions. And these score functions are used to split up the data into two different streams. A critical stream, and that are the really important records. And for the really important records, we still apply interactive editing, so we again still have people looking at the data and trying to correct the data. And we have a non-critical stream, that are the records that are unlikely to contain influential errors. Some of those records don't contain any errors at all, others may contain errors, but then these errors will be small errors, and we hope that only small errors will cancel out when we sum them up or aggregate them in some way. And with the records in the non-critical stream, we either edit them automatically, and I will explain automatic editing later, or in some cases we don't do anything at all. We just say, well, there may be small errors in the data, but these are not very important. And and if we aggregate them, well, the estimates will be more or less okay. And when selective editing was introduced in those days, well, people were a bit scared of leaving some small errors in the data. But a lot of studies have shown that, well, it's perfectly okay to leave small errors in the data, and that the other situation where you edit all the records is even more dangerous, because there you have the probability or the chance that you start over-editing and start doing too much. Well, how does that more or less work, a score function? When you use a score function, you have to construct a score for a record, and we call that a global score, and that global score is the combination of scores for a number of variables or important target parameters, and we call that the local scores. And the local scores are often defined as a product of two different components. we have the likelihood of a potential error, so the risk. What's the risk that we have a record with an error here? And the contribution to the estimated target parameter. What's the influence on the total we're interested in? We measure the risk by comparing the observed value to something that we would more or less expect. And we call that the anticipated value. And the anticipated value may be based on statistical models. For instance, on models based on data from a previous period. And the influence is measured by, the relative contribution of the anticipated value to the estimated total. And the records with a high score, or higher than a certain threshold, we send them to the critical stream, so they will be edited interactively, and the other records below the threshold will not be edited interactively, and they will either be done automatically or not at all. So I will now say a few words about risk and the influence. Let's see where I am. Well, as I said, we often measure the risk by comparing the observed value, that's in this case the xij, the observed value of variable j in a record I, and we compare that to what we would anticipate, the anticipated value xij hat, and we divide it by xij hat. So and if we have a large deviation, if the observed value deviates a lot from the anticipated value, it's an indication that we may be looking at an error there, and small deviations, there's no reason to suspect that there's an error. And if there's an error, it's a small one. And the influence is often measured by a product of the design weight, the sampling weight or the server weight, times the absolute value of the anticipated value. And if you multiply that, the risk component and the influence component, we get this wonderful, very simple formula for local core of variable j in a unit I is equal to the design weight times the absolute difference between the observed value and the anticipated value. So it's a really simple formula. And that measures if we have or could have a large error in a certain variable. And if we want to have a score for a record, we have to combine those things. We can do that in several ways. That's also one of the things I like about statistical data editing. You can do the same things often in many different ways. So if you wish, you can write a lot of papers on it. The global scores, to combine the local scores, we first scale them, and before we combine them into a global score. For instance, we divide the local scores by the approximated total of the variable, or we divide it by the standard deviation of the anticipated values. Once we have done that, we can construct a global score. We can do that by taking the sum of the local scores, or we can also do that by taking a maximum of the local scores. And there are many things in between, but in any case, you can combine the local scores into a global score. And you can use that to for your selective editing process. And this is more or less the most common approach that has been used up to now. Let's move on to automatic editing. I really like automatic editing because I'm a bit lazy myself and I don't have any subject matter knowledge about anything. And the idea of automatic editing is let the computer do all the work. And the main role of a person is to provide the computer with all kind of information, all kind of metadata, such as the edits that have to be satisfied. We also put in some imputation models, and perhaps some information about what is important, what is not important, and then we press a button and then we drink a cup of coffee. Yeah, and in the former days, you often had to drink many liters of coffee because the computers were a bit slow. But unfortunately, they have become faster, so now you can drink only one cup of coffee. So I really like this. In automatic editing, we divide the kind of errors into two kinds: systematic errors, that are errors that are reported consistently among some of the responding units, and for which we understand the mechanism. We understand why the errors are there. And we also have random errors, and that are the errors for which we don't know the underlying mechanism, and they seem to occur randomly. Or stated differently, if you understand why the errors are there, we call them systematic, and if you don't understand it, we call them random. And that makes us feel better, because if you don't understand it, we say, oh, it's just a random thing, so that's not very important that I don't understand it. But we hope in the future that a lot of the random errors will become systematic ones. What are kind of examples of systematic errors? A very important kind of error are thousand errors, that are values that are reported in units instead of thousands of units. That happens in business surveys a lot. We ask businesses to report their financial figures in thousands of dollars or thousands of pesos or thousands of euros, and they don't do that. They don't understand our question, and they report in units. And then suddenly they don't have a turnover of $1 million, but of $1 billion. And that's a bit too much. And that happens a lot in our business surveys. It also happens when we get data from our tax office. If you look at that data, there are also 1,000 errors in it. So that was a bit surprising when we saw that for the first time. But it's quite easy to do to detect these kind of errors. We just compare the data with data from the previous year or data from similar enterprises. Other examples of systematic errors are typing errors, where digits are mistyped or interchanged or minus signs are forgotten, or where pairs of revenues and costs that were interchanged by accident, and rounding errors. And they can be detected and corrected by using various mathematical techniques. And I'm not going to explain any of those techniques, but my colleague Sander Scholders did a lot of work on that. And if you're really interested in this topic, you just search on the internet, you will find a lot of papers by him. And Sander is, by the way, the best statistician I've ever known in my life, although he didn't study any statistics either and hasn't finished his PhD yet. But he's one of the few persons, if you ask him a question, he will come back to you and answer the question. And that's really surprising. He would be a terrible politician because he actually gave an answer to a question. But he's a wonderful colleague and a brilliant statistician. And there may be other errors that are specific for a certain topic or a certain branch of industry. And there we often use correction rules that are specified by people who really understand that specific branch of industry. And they are specified by Shopee and Meta experts. Of course, I won't say anything about that. The methods for the random errors, I already said, they occur by accident, and we haven't found any systematic reason yet. And you can apply several methods to correct random errors, and they can be subdivided into three classes. Deterministic checking rules, or correcting rules, I should say. For instance, if the components do not sum up to a certain total, we just say the total is wrong, and we're going to correct the total. And we don't know if it is a good rule or not, but in some cases we apply rules like this. They are simple to apply, We also have methods based on statistical models and outlier techniques. You can make a model for your data and then apply an outlier technique, and the outlier is probably the value that's incorrect, and you have to edit that. I will say a few words about the last class of methods, methods based on solving a mathematical optimization problem. It's often based on a paradigm proposed by Ivan Velleghi and Tim Holt, I guess, in 1976. It's within the world of statistical offices, it's a very well-known paradigm, and everyone knows what, more or less knows what Velleghi-Holt is. It just says that the data in each record should be made to satisfy all the edits by changing as few fields as possible. If you can correct, if you can satisfy all the edits by changing only one field, we'll change only the value of that specific field. And if you have to change two fields, we'll change only two fields, but won't change three or four or five, but we'll change only those two. So we change as few fields as possible. We can construct a mathematical optimization problem for that, and it's actually not too difficult. The target function is just to change as few fields as possible. So we just we give each field a weight one and take the sum of the weights. That's our target function. And the constraints we have is, yes, it's just simply that the modified record should satisfy all the specified edits. And then you can try to solve this, and you can do it in many different ways. There's an original algorithm proposed by Velleghi and Holt in the same paper from 1976. You can use a Brown branch and bound algorithm. You can use other kinds of algorithms. But nowadays you can also use standard solvers for mathematical optimization problems. If you you can find them for free on the internet. You can use R packages or LP solve, and if you find one of those, you can quickly implement the Velleghi-Holt paradigm and an algorithm for that. So I'm going to say a few words on this. A drawback of what I'm going to say is that it only works for numerical data and not for categorical data. So it doesn't work for variables like gender or marital status. If you want to apply the Velleghi-Holt paradigm for that, you have to use another kind of algorithm. But what I'm going to explain now, it does work for numerical data, and it's quite easy for numerical data. If we have observed values, the axis with a superscript zero on top, those are the observed values, and we have corrected values, the axis without a superscript, these are the corrected values, but unknown. We have to determine them. For technical reasons, we assume that the data are bounded, but fortunately, statistical data that we have are always bounded, although the bound may be large. So we assume that the axes are between an alpha and a beta, and it may depend on the record that we have. And then the entire problem that you have to solve is here. You have to minimize the sum of the y's. And the y's either have to be 0 or they have to be 1. And we have constraints. The constraints are the x's have to satisfy all the edits. And we have a constraint that connects the x's to the y's. And it may look difficult, but fortunately the translators will explain it to you. It's not that difficult. If the y is equal to 0, then on the left hand side you will just get the observed value, and the same on the right hand side. If the y is equal to 0 on the right hand side, you also get the observed value. So you just get that the unknown x should be equal to the observed value for x. And if the y is equal to 1, if you fill it in, you'll find that on the left hand side you get the alpha term back. And on the right-hand side, you get the beta term back. So it just says that the unknown x should be between the upper and the lower bound in that particular record. So it just gives you back what you already knew. And if you find a free solver for this kind of optimization problems, you can quickly solve it. And it doesn't have to take much time to implement it. Oh, this is more or less what I already said. If y is equal to zero, then the x is equal to the observed value, and we assume that the observed value is correct. And if y is equal to one, the x is not equal to the observed value, and we assume that the observed value is incorrect. And then we delete the observed value and later impute that field. We could also have used the value that was found by the solver, but that's just a value that was found by an optimization program, and it may be better to impute it, that field, by using a statistical model. And I say it may be better, I mean by that, I'm sure it will be better to use an imputation model. Okay. These were micro editing techniques. I'll now move on to macro editing. I start with a really strange sentence because I say macro editing offers solutions to some of the problems of micro editing. That sounds a bit strange because you're not aware that there were any problems with micro editing. So, and again, I sound like a politician because I'm offering you a solution to a problem you didn't even know that existed yet. But the problem with micro editing is you're only looking at individual records and you never look at the entire data set. So you may end up with records that each of the records looks wonderful and perfectly consistent, satisfy all the edits, and then you look at the data set as a total and it's a complete mess. So that might happen. So macro editing that aims to solve that kind of problem. It checks whether the data set as a whole, if that's plausible. And it can also look at the distribution of the data. And again, we have different kinds of methods for that. There are two forms. I usually have three forms, but now I have two forms. One of them is the aggregation method. It's a fancy word for something that you would always do. If you have edited your data, you start calculating your population totals or whatever you want to publish. And what any sensible person would do is compare what you got with what you got the last time, or compare what you've got now to related data. So if you want to publish information about turnover, we'll look at what turnover did we publish last year and the years before, and we'll also look at how many employees are there. And that has to be reasonable. It's quite unusual that things completely change within 1 year or are completely unrelated to other variables. So that's called the aggregation method. The other is the distribution method. With the distribution method, you use all the micro-edited material that you have and put it into one big data set, and then you use that data to characterize the data distribution. So you find the distribution of the data and you start comparing individual values with the distribution. And for that, often visualizations are used, so you make a plot of your data, a scatter plot or another kind of plot. And the data that are outliers in those plots, they are likely to still contain some kind of error. And in the software that has been developed over the years, you can usually click on such an outlier in your plot and then drill down to the underlying data, to the individual record, and then immediately edit that specific record. So you look at the distribution, look at the outliers, click on them, and start editing them. Okay, this was what I wanted to say about statistical data editing. I have a few words about imputation, just to mention the techniques, I guess. But later there will be other speakers and who will tell you much more about imputation, and they will tell you the truth about imputation. I will say just a few words. This is discovering the unknown. We don't have any data. Still, we want to know what are those data. What can we possibly say about data that are not there? And the main problem of imputation is to preserve the statistical distribution of the complete but partly unknown data. And there are many imputation techniques, a lot of them, and they are described in many excellent books and articles. And I always found it amazing how much you can say about data that are non-existent, so nothing. And again, I sound like a politician because they can also speak for hours about nothing. But it's possible, and it's actually complicated stuff. I will just mention a few simple methods. The first univariate imputation method, this is a very simple kind of imputation method, is the mean imputation, where you divide your data into certain classes depending on auxiliary data, and within each class you impute the mean of the variable that you want to impute. And in the case of categorical data, you can impute the mode. It's a very simple method, but it's quite often used at statistical offices. Ratio method, that's quite related to mean imputation. With ratio imputation, you take the value of an auxiliary variable and you multiply that times an estimated ratio, and you impute that value. And again, this is quite often used at statistical offices, at least at Statistics Netherlands. And in particular, it's quite often used when you have longitudinal data. Then if we want to impute the turnover of an enterprise in this year, but we don't have it for this year. But we do have the turnover from last year. We calculate the expected, the estimated growth of the turnover, and multiply with the turnover from last year, and we get an estimate for the turnover for this year. Ratio imputation is a simple example of regression imputation. It's much more complicated. In the regression imputation, you don't have just a ratio, but you estimate an entire regression model, and then impute your data using that regression model with or without a stochastic term. This was for univariate data. Of course, we also have multivariate data. Especially for categorical data, so-called random Hardack is often used. In any case, Statistics Netherlands run a random Hardack for categorical data, it's basically used all the time. In the random Hardack, you again use auxiliary data to define classes, and within each class you draw a random donor, and you just take the values from the random donor and use that to impute your record. A variant is a nearest neighbor Hardack imputation. There you don't use a random record, but you calculate distances, and then you take the closest donor and use the values from the closest donor to impute your record. Finally, maximum likelihood imputation. I guess it's basically a method to estimate model parameters. For instance, for multivariate normal data, and then you use it's quite complicated to estimate the model parameters for a multivariate when you have multivariate missing data. And then you use the values predicted by the model, and use that to impute the data. And again, you can do it with or without a stochastic error term, depending on what you want. a few words about variance of imputed data. Of course, we're also interested in the quality of our data. One way to look at the quality of your data is by calculating the variance. But if you apply a standard variance formula to imputed data, it will almost always underestimate the variance. And you can correct for that in several ways. you can find the correct estimate for your variance by multiply imputing the data. I'm not going to say much about that, but I guess Jörg is going to explain about that tomorrow or later today. And then multiple imputation, parameters, model parameters varied by drawing from a prior distribution. If you don't want to use multiple imputation, you can also use resampling methods like the bootstrap or the jackknife. And in resampling methods, you start varying the data and not the, model parameters. And by varying the data, you can also find the correct estimates for your variance. Nowadays, multiple imputation has more or less become this standard. And people are starting to find it strange if you write about imputation and you don't use multiple imputation. This was about imputation in general. I guess there are two specific imputation problems at national statistical institutes. And sometimes we try to take these problems into account, and sometimes we don't. We do that because it's quite hard to take them into account. One of the problems is certifying edits, and the other is preserving totals. For national statistical offices, for some reason, logically consistent data are important. So we don't want to have impossible combinations in our data. So we, in our data, we don't want to have pregnant men. We just don't want to have articles in newspapers saying the number of pregnant men had drastically increased last year. So preferably, we want to have consistent data. So if possible, our imputation should satisfy the edit restrictions that we have. And the other specific problem, I guess, for national statistical offices is that, well, sometimes some statistical offices have adopted a one-figure policy for some of their statistics, because it's extremely hard to have a one-figure policy. And the one-figure policy, if you publish something on a certain phenomenon, and you have a new table, a more detailed table, in principle, you would like to publish the same number as you already had. We don't want to publish several numbers, for instance, on unemployment. We don't want to have several numbers on unemployment. But it's extremely hard to apply this one-figure policy. And in practice, statistic analysis, if you look at our data and search really well, you'll find we have different numbers for unemployment, but we try to hide it from the general public. And as we say, well, we sometimes try to adopt this policy because we don't want to confuse the users of our data. What we actually mean is we don't want to have any nasty questions from users or journalists or politicians. How we can have can possibly have two different numbers on unemployment or two different numbers on the gross domestic product. So I guess this is quite specific for national statistical institutes. I've hardly seen this in the general literature on imputation. A few words about statistical data editing, and then after that I still have a few words about the practice. A few words of first, the future of statistical data editing. Of course, I have no idea at all, but I'm supposed to say something here. Well, first of all, many technical points have to be answered. For instance, how do you possibly can you possibly combine selective editing and automatic editing as efficiently as possible? We do combine them, but I guess they could be combined much more efficiently and much more effectively as well as we do now. Big data is a big issue, so we should pay a lot more attention to big data. Well, I have no idea what big data are, but people often say it has something to do with volume. You have a lot of data, it has to do something with velocity. The data change very quickly, and it has to do with variety. There are a lot of different kinds of big data sources. And we have to do something with this. But the methods that I described are hardly suited for big data. The methods that I described today require that we can that you have a lot of structure, and they require that we have a lot of knowledge about these data. For instance, you have to have edit rules. But if you get a big data sort with all kinds of different events, well, they're often not very structured, and often the knowledge of big data is very limited. So in many cases, I assume in most cases, traditional editing techniques, as I described, are not very suitable for big data. Well, there is some hope for the future. Well, at Statistics Netherlands, we have, for instance, applied the use of, applied signal processing techniques to edit traffic loop data, traffic loops. Sometimes you have loops in the road, and they send an electronic signal if you drive over such a loop. We have I don't know 60,000 of them in the Netherlands, and it's far and they send off a signal every 10 seconds or so. So it's far too much to process in any traditional way. But if you use signal processing techniques, we do get acceptable results. And hopefully data science methods or machine learning techniques may be very useful here. And our hope is on the machine learning techniques. People have always tended to see statistical data editing as a way of finding, of detecting and correcting errors. But as Leopold Grundqvist from Statistics Sweden has said 20 years ago, or maybe even much longer ago, but in any case, this quote is from a paper from 20 years ago. It is not the entire quality process. It's just a part of the total quality improvement process. And what could be much more important than finding errors in the data and correcting them could be assessing the quality of edited data and using the knowledge that you get from the editing process to improve your surveys later on. So you see that people make a lot of mistakes on the first question on your questionnaire. The most logical step would be to redesign the questionnaire and to reformulate the first question. But it hardly ever happens in practice. So we should still do this. Finally, last slide on the future of statistical data editing, and then go to the practice at Statistics Netherlands a little bit. Is moving from single-source statistics to multi-source statistics. Traditionally, only survey data were available, but nowadays we have much more data, such as administrative div data and big data. And instead of editing each source separately, it's probably much more effective and much more efficient to edit them jointly, to edit them together. And another thing about if you have multiple sources, it also opens opportunities for other statistical methods. For instance, latent variable models, where we have multiple observations from different data sets for the same variable, but they will always be different. You will always find if you have multiple observations of the same variable, there are different values there. But you can try to use latent variable models where you see the true value as a latent variable, and the observations as indicators for the truth. And of course, imputation, satisfying edits, and preserving totals, it has become much more important if you have multiple sources. Finally, I got 0 seconds left, or more or less like this. How do we do it in practice? Theory practice is always very simple. But it's not very simple to practice theory. It's always extremely complicated. Even the most simple formulas become very complicated in practice. How do we do it at Statistics Netherlands? All the statistical data editing techniques have their own advantages and disadvantages. So at the statistical offices, we try to integrate various statistical data editing techniques. And we hope in that way to overcome the drawbacks of the individual techniques. For instance, for business data, a typical editing strategy for business data is to start with correcting the systematic and the obvious errors, if you know for certain that there's an error in a certain variable in a certain record, that the most logical thing you can do is just correct it. And then for business data, we use selective editing to split the data in a critical and a non-critical stream, and edit the critical stream interactively in a non-critical stream. We usually do that automatically at Statistics Netherlands. And after we've done it on a micro level, we apply macro editing. And this is the process, the general strategy that we've implemented for instance, for our annual structural business statistics. And these are more or less the most important business statistics that Statistics Netherlands produces. Although national accounts won't agree with us about this. For social data, the typical editing strategy is a little bit different. That's mainly caused because selective editing is very difficult to apply for persons. You can apply selective editing for enterprises because one enterprise is much bigger than the other enterprise, but all the persons are the same. A person is a person. There's not much to distinguish persons. So here we have a process where, again, we start with correcting systematic and obvious errors. Then we usually use deterministic checking and correcting rules, and we call that micro-integration. And after micro-integration, we again apply macro-editing to see if it's the data set as a whole is more or less okay. Okay, well, we're almost there. How do we do it in practice, part two? And this is very important. I'm finally going to say something important. We try to keep it as simple as possible. We try to avoid the use of complicated models. We've always been very reluctant to use model-based techniques. Well, one reason is that we don't want to be accused of partiality and manipulating our results to favor a certain model or favor a certain political opinion. We always have to be very careful if we say something about unemployment. We don't want to use a model for that. And then the left-wing party say, well, you used the wrong model. The right-wing party said, you used the correct model, or the other way around. So we are usually working design-based and not model-based. Another reason, and may in fact be even more important, we produce many statistics on a day-to-day routine, and finding the best model for certain statistics would be very time-consuming, and we just don't have time for that, and we don't have time for that. So we often rely on simple techniques. Well, this is my last wheel slide. Well, unfortunately, even if you try to keep it as simple as possible, it's not simple. For our structural business statistics, we have a simple selective editing strategy based on score functions like I described. So you just compare it to an anticipated value. And we have simple imputation techniques like mean imputation and ratio imputation. But for some enterprises, we have administrative data that we can use for selective editing and imputation. So we, of course, if you have that data, we're going to use that. And that complicates the process a little bit. For other enterprises, we don't have administrative data, but we do have data from a previous period, maybe the previous period before, or the period before that, and we still want to use that, of course, and we're not going to throw that away. And that complicates the process a little bit more. And for some other enterprises, we don't have data from previous periods, we don't have administrative data, but we still have data from other related survey. And of course, we want to use that. We're not going to throw that away. And that complicates the process a little bit more. So for our structural annual business surveys, we use a simple selective editing and imputation strategy. But we have written that down in the entire methodology, and we ended up with hundreds of pages, and these were just simple selective editing and simple imputation models. So, summarizing my slide, my talk, and I guess life in general, if you even if you keep it simple, it will become complicated. And having said that, thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, I will gladly make an attempt to answer your question. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot. Well, we have about 5 minutes left to answer some questions or for some comments. Norma will give us a hand with a microphone.
Thank you for your talk. I have a quick question. If you're using, have you used any machine learning techniques to check on your simpler models?
Is that a simple question?
Is it? Okay, sorry.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
I'm worried about
I understand kind of keeping things simple, yeah. Right? Yeah. Have you used machine learning just as a check in the background? No.
No, I guess not. We have used machine learning techniques, and we are always testing them. But I guess we're trying to solve the big problem and not use that as a check for our simple techniques.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Is there another question or comments?
Oh, software?
Yeah. Do you have a recommendation of some software for example, for the problem of minimizing the number of changes?
Oh,
is
yeah.
Is that simple to do, or are there?
Well, for the automatic better. For automatic editing, my colleagues Mark van der Loo and Edwin de Jonge have written an R package called Edit Rules. And that R package that contains functions that do the automatic editing. And I know that Italian colleagues have made also an R package, so it's also for free, and that's for selective editing. And I forgot the name, but it's probably called Select Edit or Edit Select. If you shuffle the words around and combined in a different way, you will find it. And if you can't find it, you can contact me. But they have developed software for selective editing and statistic analysis for automatic editing.
Okay. I think it was another question over there.
Thank you. Well, if you have, for example, multiple time series for let's say the overturn of multiple enterprises and you want to impute the most recent overturn, what method would you recommend to do that?
Ooh, wow. I'm trying to think what we do at Statistic Analysis. I'm not sure if I would recommend that, by the way, but I'm trying to think what we do. I guess we just use simple ratio imputation for the individual time series. And then perhaps some macro integration technique that makes sure that everything that should sum up still sums up. So, okay. First do the individual time series and then make sure that it's consistent again.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, is there any other question or comments? If not, we would like to thank the speaker and to handle just this to be able to let you show at home to your grandchildren.
Oh, yeah.
You did not save lives in Mexico, but at least you gave a talk.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Conference. They love these things.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.